Capital Steez was born Courtney Everett DeWar Jr. in the summer of 1993 to Jamaican parents. Growing up in Brooklyn in the 90s, he would be influenced and surrounded by music his whole life, with rap legends like Jay-Z, Biggie, Nas, Mos Def, and 50 calling the borough their home. It wouldn't be long before Courtney, now going by Jamal, would try his hand at rapping. In 2009, at just 12, he released a joint mixtape called The Yellow Tape with his then best friend Jakari Jack, and the two formed a rap group called Saturday Morning Breakfast. See, we be the illest thing in the starter cab, ride the actors off the back, we got a lot to offer back. Split decision, lyricism, got a spit and venom, but sick delivery, sharp tongue, to precision. Check the rhythm, I'm toxic and phonics in. Overly confident, flow atomic with vomit spit. The rhetoric is effortless, yet everless, so every friend's kiss is the death wish we never live. Fast forward to high school, and Jamal's love for music was stronger than ever. He attended Brooklyn's Edward R. Murrow High School, a public high school where the Beastie Boys and even the legendary Jean-Michel Basquiat were all former students. The school was founded as an alternative to traditional education and encouraged students to take an interest in the arts. As a high schooler, Steez and his friends would roam around the city, skating and smoking, and even going as far as to break onto campus after hours to skate around. See, Steez had become known around school for his rhyming skills, and one day, while in the cafeteria, he walked up to a skinny freshman who had been filming raps and posting them to YouTube under the name J-O-V and asked if that was him. That freshman was Joey Badass.
Guess who's back again? I'm known to make a lose oxygen. Get sparked off in toxic oxygen. Wait, stop. Drop it in, roll over, it's what I told her. Don't play games, I can't console her. Hand it over to the guard like a controller. We overload her, she froze up, it was over. The pros expose her, her ex-proposer. They be like, you ain't that hot, I know. But they still knock my door, ask about Jehovah. My witness, label me not the Cohen. I got the sickness, sickness, get fixed with the quickness, right? Another JJ bro like dynamite. The other day I was pulled dynamite. Have nothing but the empty app.
Because Murrow High encouraged art so much, students were given free periods to do any artistic activity they wanted. So naturally, Steez and his newfound friends would spend these scheduled times hosting cyphers in the hallways and recording out of loose studios. The group of Steez, Powers Pleasant, Joey Badass, and CJ Fly would go bar for bar and come back each day trying to outdo each other. And it wouldn't be long before this group of talented young men would make their first big wave in the industry. In February of 2012, Joey Badass and Capital Steez released the song, Survival Tactics. Within weeks, Survival Tactics had garnered over 100,000 views, and as of the recording of this video, now sits at over 20 million. Less than 2 months later, in April of 2012, Capital Steez was gearing up to drop his debut mixtape, American Corruption, whose name was inspired by the Ice Cube album, America's Most Wanted. The number 47 played a big part in the album promo, and Steez described 47 as the perfect number.
But the 47 is actually, it's an angelic number.
Yeah.
If you look it up, it has a deep meaning in numerology, numbers 4 and 7. So when you put them together, it keeps a strong balance. Mm-hmm. And it adds up to 11, yeah. your pineal gland, 11th chakra, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I got this down pat. Just give it, let's say, 10 years, they're going to be like, damn, I didn't know Steez had it like that.
While the two friends geared up to drop their debut mixtapes, 1999 and American Corruption respectively, Joey was contacted by Johnny Shipes, the CEO of Cinematic Music Group, who had stumbled across a video of Joey freestyling on YouTube. Joey was just 16 at the time, but his mother worked out an arrangement with Shipes so the two could work together without signing any contracts until ready to do so. Shipes tried everything in his power to convince Joey to leave the rest of Pro Era behind, but Joey was adamant that Pro Era be a part of whatever situation they worked out. Suddenly, the crew had the backing of a manager and a promotional team, while most of its members were still in high school. At the same time, Steez dropped out of the community college in Brooklyn that he had enrolled in and started to hone his image, growing out his signature dreadlocks and working hard to lose weight. Months later, Steez had transformed from a chubby kid into a slim rapper with tattoos, seemingly overnight.
Like, if you see me like 5 months ago, you wouldn't recognize me. So like,
definitely wouldn't.
Thank you.
He was like a sumo wrestler.
You're a sumo wrestler? You transformed?
Yeah, I used to weigh like 250.
Yo, this is Bone Crusher.
As the two garnered more fame, Johnny would set up tours, music videos, and publicity for Strictly Joey. And by the time Joey was ready to drop his mixtape, 1999 in June, he already had two music videos ready to drop, as well as several interviews lined up. Compared to Joey's music videos, Steez's looked extremely low quality and amateur, and Steez even complained about it in his own interviews.
You know, yeah. I don't get hit up for interviews as much as I would like to.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just wait patiently.
You like, feel like,
I mean, really, my biggest issue, like, forgive me, but, like, Joey, he gets free clothes. I wish I got free clothes.
I wish I got free clothes, too. Have you gotten any offers from labels?
Offers from labels? I'm trying to get a buzz. Like.
Oh, so you feel like, so there's like no, do you feel like all the attention's on Joey?
I can't say that. Yeah.
You basically just did, though.
Oh, yeah, it is, though, but like, it's not hate, though.
It's like, no, it's not hate. I mean, the attention is on Joey.
But the truth is that Joey was just way more marketable than Steez. Apart from the 47 logo resembling a certain symbol of hate, Steez was also very deep into spirituality, which was way less common in 2012 than it is now. And even though Steez was clearly the better rapper, Joey was priority A1. The lack of resources caused American Corruption to flop, and it had less than 15,000 plays in its first month. He re-released the mixtape and added Reloaded to the title, along with 7 new tracks, hoping to salvage what was left of his work in October, but that didn't perform much better, even though reviews were positive. Cinematic announced a tour for Pro Era, where they would go around the country with headliners Juicy J and Smoke Dizza. Steez noticed that on the tour poster, they were introduced as Joey Badass and Pro Era, and this is when Steez began noticing that he was becoming an afterthought in the group that he had founded. After the tour, Steez began to act strange toward his family and friends. He stopped making sense when he spoke, and his tweets came off like he had a god complex and thought he was some sort of divine savior. His friends and family became very concerned about him toward the end of 2012. He would talk to Steez and not know half that he was talking about. He would say something and you'd be like, "What are you talking about? That's my best friend, my brother, and I love him." At the same time, he's a little off and he had some demons he was dealing with. We all do. If you look back to 2012, you probably remember the conspiracy theory that claimed the world would end in December, around December 21st, according to the Mayan calendar. Even though most people recognize this as absurd, Steez started making references to Doomsday all over social media and to friends and family. In early November, a few days after Hurricane Sandy hit New York, he met up with Jakari Jack, and as they walked to a bus stop where they would say their final goodbyes, Steez said something that made his friend pause. "If the world doesn't end, something really big is gonna happen, and it's gonna change our lives." I can still remember the way he said it. So what's running through my mind, what the fuck is gonna happen?
Yeah, I've been doing a little bit like, I didn't even record this shit yet. It's like, what's the real shit? So yeah, I don't feel it, I don't care, because it's real, you know? Like, I have no other choice but to feel it. Emancipated from mental slavery, there's words in my roster. So my mind, so I got my head locked up. My third eye chakra was blocked in the flesh of the cockpit. Indigo, path that I follow, there's words in my father. Watch when the Babylon passes. Stash in my basketball pen. Got enough fire to light up my old camp. I and I never thought to inspire a grown man.
The last time Steez performed was at the Public Assembly in Williamsburg on December 12, 2012. His set didn't go well. Steez was drunk and apparently frustrated with the turnout, and he even walked off stage at one point. While shooting a video a few days later, Steez told Cinematic's Jesse Rubin that he was done with the rap industry. "He honestly said a couple of things to me that really concerned me at the shoot. Just the look in his eyes, he was like, I'm just done with this shit." During the last week of his life, he had even withdrawn from his closest friends and family and would spend multiple days indoors. He told his mother that he was worried about being under investigation for his 47 stickers and that the only way he would get rid of that whole situation was if he hurt himself. See, Steez lived in a Jewish neighborhood, and because of the 47 logo's striking resemblance to another not-so-good symbol, Steez was being investigated for hate crimes.
The investigation.
It's under investigation from who?
I think 70th precinct.
Oh, okay, for what?
Yeah, like, it's considered a hate crime because we live in a Jewish neighborhood. Like, because basically Jews bought out Flatbush.
Yeah.
And that 47 sticker, they think it's a symbol. And we actually find out that there's this specific group of n****s called the Wolf's Angel. And they have a that looks more like the 47 sticker than we thought. I mean, like, I'm going to continue using it because it's not tied. And my homie Dirty Sanchez, he actually made their logo look doper. So I'm like, we're just some mad geniuses.
On December 23rd, Pro Era would drop a collaborative mixtape called Peep the Apocalypse. That night, Pro Era had a party at the Stussy store in Soho to celebrate the mixtape's release. The event was jam-packed, but according to people there, there was something off about Steez. He blew up when someone asked him to sign a t-shirt and no one brought him a Sharpie. And a couple of videos from the event show Steez looking completely dazed, slurring his words, eyes half closed, and lacking energy in general. The next night, Steez and the group were at Premiere Studios, the studio Cinematic was using in Midtown. It was here Steez told some of the Pro Era members that he was thinking of himself by jumping off the building where Cinematic had its offices. A handful of the members tried to talk him out of it, but it was too late. He made up his mind already. Nobody seems to know exactly what happened with Steez the next day. Mrs. DeWar had gone to sleep, thinking her son was at home, but awoke later that night when one of the group members showed up at the door, worried and looking for Steez. She immediately called the squad hotline, and a police report notes a call was placed around 12:15 a.m. Hansen says she called Sanchez that night around 1 a.m. as the worry about Steez began to spread. He sped out with a friend in a car and met up with the rest of Pro Era there. He said the group searched the park for about an hour and a half calling for Steez, but it was too late. While friends as well as law enforcement were on the search for Steez, he was making his way to the Cinematic Group building. A guard at the building said Steez was let in because he counted as an employee, and at some point walked up to the roof where he used to freestyle with the rest of Pro Era on better days. Steez had texted Hansen telling her that he was about to smoke, and at 11:54 p.m. he had sent a message to Shirley Tajida, another girl that he was friends with, saying, "I love you." And with one final message to his fans, he simply tweeted, "The end." The next morning, Capital Steez was found in the alleyway across from the Cinematic building. He had jumped in the moments after midnight, and NYPD told the family that he was found clutching a Bible to his chest. Though it may be a coincidence, it's worth noting that the numbers and the date, 12-23-12, add up to 47. The aftershock of Steez's death hit the family the hardest. "The other day I went to visit my mom and we broke down because every day she tries to calculate in her head, what the fuck happened to my son? What emotional stuff was he going through that we didn't see as a family?" The story of Capital Steez is one that ended before it began. A young man, only 19 years old, gone before his life could even get off the ground. In life, there are two deaths. The first death happens when your heart stops beating, and the second death happens when you're thought about for the last time. Even though Courtney DeWar may not be with us physically, he lives on in everyone who we influenced, in every person who hears a song, saw a show, or listens to an interview. Capital Steez lives on.
I get some angles from all this. I know what most things in the magic is. All that tears I changed it. I said I wanna be a red star. Monster, black cars and fast cars. Fuck Ferraris, a party of parties. I wanna change the world. I'm awfully sorry. That can even be the next car. Body, cross the Garvey of a hard disguise. Follow MLK. I guess I can't explain.